So, good afternoon everyone. Thank you all for joining us for our session. Welcome to the Green Lounge. If you're first joining us, welcome back if you're coming back for our session. So today, I'll be your host. My name is Adam Murky. I'll be moderating our session, Forging a Path Toward Low-Carbon Steel, Salzgitter and Salkos. I'm joined today by Martin Zapper and Hans-Jörg Krasnick. Martin Zapper is Program Director at Salkos, with 10 years of experience in the energy business with a focus on transformation. Thank you for being here, Martin. Hans-Jörg Krasnick is Head of Electric Steelmaking at Primetals Technologies, started his career in production with electric steelmaking, and has been at Primetals Technologies for 10 years. So thank you, Hans-Jörg.
Thank you, Adam.
Thank you. Fantastic. So, to start our session, Martin, let's start simply with Salkos. What is Salkos? What does it stand for? What are the goals? What's the project outline? Tell us a bit about Salkos and the Salkos project.
Well, first of all, thanks, Adam, for having us and having the ability to share a bit what our view is on Salkos and the steel industry. Salkos stands for Salzgitter Low CO2 Steelmaking, the big transformation project that we are currently undertaking in the campus at Salzgitter, our flat steel unit. We aim to reduce the carbon emissions by 95% over the next 10 years. We have taken an investment decision for phase number one, going into operation by the end of 2025, starting 26. We will invest into a big direct reduction plant, electric arc furnace, as well as an electrolyzer on site.
Very good. So, regarding the Primetals involvement in the Salkos project, Hans-Jörg.
Salzgitter is truly the first mover in this transition period, and we are truly proud of being part in the Salkos program with our electric steelmaking portfolio and our electric steelmaking plant. So, we will supply a most modern 220-ton electric arc furnace, including the auxiliary and infrastructure. And thank you, Martin, for teaming up with Primetals in that regard.
Yeah. So Martin, could you tell us a bit, what was the key decision factor? How did Salkos and Salzgitter sort of come to the conclusion to undertake business with Primetals Technologies? What was sort of the experience there?
Well, we have launched the very specific Salkos execution phase like a year or two ago, with having a procurement process, having secured public funding. We have secured the funding overall, we have taken investment decision, and we have also done a competitive process in order to find out who's the best partner for us at Salzgitter. Most convincing were a couple of items, just to name some of them. One is certainly the quick ramp up, the high availability of the Primetals technology. The heat recovery, the energy efficiency has been very, very crucial for us as well, as we are since many, many years focusing as well as on energy efficiency anyway. So that was a very good fit as well from Primetals. But most important is that we at Salzgitter aim to deliver into the market high quality flat steel. And for that one particularly, the metallurgical fit and competence of Primetals was most convincing. So within that process, we were really happy to have Primetals as a partner on our side for that electric arc furnace.
Fantastic. Hans-Jörg, I have a question that you mentioned briefly. You said that Salzkos and Salzgitter is really starting and demonstrating that this transition is underway. So how does Primetals see the role not only just of electric steelmaking, but these types of projects? Is this just the beginning? Is this the future of the steel industry in Europe?
It's just the beginning. Salzgitter is the first mover. The transformation of an existing integrated steel plant with long traditions like Salzgitter's towards an electric arc furnace-based melt shop requires significant changes into the production process, but also in the plant infrastructure. These are really big challenges to master, and for that challenges you need expertise, you need best technology, you need process know-how, you need also not only technology, you need also expertise in project management, in logistics, environmental technology, automation, digitalization. So, and this new plant, which will be ramped up end of 2025, we will have the most advanced automation and digitalization technology in place. We have robotic supported electric steel making processes. We have condition monitoring systems installed, which gives intelligent recommendations for the plant operation. The environmental regulation. We have an encapsulated dockhouse to reduce the noise emissions. So we are really looking forward to execute this project together with you.
Well, if I can just add, the question was, is that one of many to come, or is that the one and only on it? Well, looking into this, into the legislation, looking into customer demands, looking into overall society's requests, we all want to decarbonize. There is a legislation set in place, particularly for Germany, 2045 is when we have to have the industry decarbonized. At Salzgitter, that we want to be far ahead of the legislation, but nonetheless, the CO2 emission in the steel industry alone in Germany stands for 7%. At Salzgitter, it's 1%. If we just add up on all that one, we are at present the first ones within the transformation. We have secured the funding. We have secured investment decisions. That's really, really good. But this is one of the first of many to come. We are pretty convinced of that one. So it's within Europe at least. We are at the forefront, but there's many more to come, and I'm also looking forward to see them taking their investment decisions.
Maybe to add something, at the moment, approximately 30% of the global global steel production is based on electric arc furnace route, and we expect that within the next three decades, this share of electric steelmaking will rise up to 50% of the global steel production.
So we're experiencing a lot of the pressures, both from legislation, as you mentioned, and also we see this trend moving towards electric steelmaking. What are some of the challenges that the industry will face going forward 10 years? If everyone switched tomorrow to electric steelmaking, that might be a bit impractical. Mm. So what are these challenges, and how are not only Salzgitter, but also Primetals, what's the anticipation of these projects and how to overcome these bottlenecks? Hans-Jürgen, please.
Maybe. Okay, from the outside, a big challenge is the energy, the renewable energy supply. And there is a lot going on out there. There are massive investments ongoing. The electrical power grid will be expanded in Europe, but not only in Europe. There's only one way to go, investing into renewable energy. Yeah. The future is electric. And for challenge for us as company, as stakeholder in such a big project, these are massive investments. There are many, many stakeholders involved. There are many, many interfaces. And a success factor is, for a successful project execution, to have a clear understanding at the very beginning about the scope, the deliverable, and the interfaces. And Salzgitter already had a very clear picture about their expectations. So they did a lot of efforts at the very beginning. They visited a lot of reference plants worldwide. So the picture of Salzgitter was very clear. And this is a key to success.
Yeah, from an overall picture, I think I mentioned now that we have taken investment decisions. But investment decision being taken last year, a year in which we still have and still an ongoing war in Ukraine. We had a pandemic that was yet not over. We still have a supply chain, international supply chains being disturbed by many, many circumstances. Inflation rates, particularly last year. So there is a lot of challenges in order to come to a decision point. That's for us luckily passed, but looking into where we are by today, I mean, it's a 2.3, 2.2, 2.4 billion project. It's large scale. We have hundreds of people just alone in Salzgitter, and we need more of them. We have suffered in the past, particularly of individual competencies not being available. Civil engineering is a competence that we were lacking. So if you don't have civil engineers, you might have challenges to just invest into these areas. So that we need more competent people. We need people that are willing to go really into the projects, go on site and do the work without being blinded that I want to work from elsewhere. It's just alone mobile working. It's an important topic, mobile working. but you also need to have the people that want to go to where it hurts and also have the patience in order to overcome such a long period and long-lasting projects. 2026 is in 3 years, but you need to have the patience and the competence and the people to overcome these periods. So there is, energy is definitely a topic by today. We import energy by means of coal. We will also import energy in the future by means of hydrogen. Where this will come from, yet to be decided, yet to be defined. We have taken a decision to invest into an electrolyzer 100 megawatt on our site, one of a size that, at least at present in Germany, doesn't even exist. So we are ramping up, and on the one side it doesn't exist in that size, on the other side it will only supply us with 5% of the demand on hydrogen that we will see. So taking the two biggest players in Germany together, that means we need an equivalent of hydrogen capacity in the range of 10 gigawatt, just alone to supply those two big companies, and we have like more than two companies just alone in Germany, not even speaking about Europe. So energy, build out of offshore wind, build out of onshore wind, build out of renewable energy is key. That will happen near shore, that will happen onshore, that will happen close to our vicinity, but also important is that, of course, we need an international supply chain and energy coming from elsewhere on the planet, like we today import coal as well. So it's not new, but just in a different shape and form.
Martin, one more challenge to tackle. It's the metallurgy. Yeah? We need to introduce new steel grades in the electric arc furnace-based routes, automotive steel grades. So we have a lot to do. There's a lot of research ongoing. It's about scrap quality, residual. It's about crafted scrap, screening, cleaning, all that stuff we need to cope up during the ramp up then.
Now, can I just say or ask, does that put really the steel industry and a project like Salkus in an opportunity to redefine what heavy industry looks like in Europe? I mean, are these new clean electric, as you said, the future is electric, and these renewable projects, is this an opportunity for essentially the metals industry to really push other sectors to start expanding these things a lot faster? There's got to be this increase in handshake. And is Salzgitter or Salkus, are they cooperating with more partners that maybe you didn't cooperate with before in regions to start expanding these projects? And is that also going to play a role? Yes.
Well, with like having seen how the energy business worked in the past years and the transformation within the energy business, we have also, which I think is a very wise way to do within our strategy, implemented that we will do that in partnership. So partnering for transformation is a key and very vital directive for us. We have partners like with Primetals. We have then in other technology areas, we have built up a wide range of partners within our customer sectors, those who want to like decarbonize as well. We have partnered up with a lot of those in order to develop steel grades together with them on a new route. We have partners on the energy side who in the future also we need more to import. By today we are self-sufficient when it comes to electrical power, but in the future we need to import, we need to buy power, electrical power, in the amount of a large-scale city within Germany. So we will demand a lot of renewable energy. Of those, we have also partnered up as well as on the raw material side. So this is a crucial element for us. And the question, I think, just to add on that one, what does result from that one? We have now taken a decision. We have taken a decision in order to come from PowerPoint slides, we go into real-life execution. This demands a lot of industries to follow. We are now demanding the industry suppliers with 150,000 tons per year on hydrogen. This is also a business opportunity, of course, for all these companies who want to bring their own PowerPoint slides into their business case and decision points. This is what will follow afterwards. We have taken one, now it's up for the others. You have now set the demand side ready. We need the others to follow as well.
Exactly. I mean, electric steelmaking is triggering a lot of developments, yeah? Also in other industries. Think about artificial intelligence, digitalization, automation, or booths on the other side. It's amazing what's going on out there with regard to digitalization, and the topics are triggering a lot. And steel, you need steel as backbone in a society. For wind power plants, you need steel. And if this steel is made green, even better.
Yeah, always. So one question I did also have is we talk a lot about decarbonization in the context of these types of projects. There's a large focus on carbon emissions, which is exceptionally important. What other aspects, not only of our supply to Salzgitter from a Primetals perspective, but what other environmental aspects are really essential to projects like these? And what other technological aspects are essential to projects like these? Hans-Jörg, you mentioned automation and digitalization also built into that, but what other factors are part of this network or landscape that we see?
For emission control, emissions starting at the off-gas duct, we start to recover the heat from the off-gas. We will build the largest waste heat recovery system ever installed in a steelmaking plant to produce steam, which can be utilized in the existing steel plant or which can be utilized for electrical energy production. Emission control, we have a dockhouse for dust collection, we have the filter dusting system fulfilling the most stringent environmental requirements, we have a water treatment plant installed there, so there are so many aspects to consider. This is a big industry, it's a huge plant.
So any other environmental aspects that are also driving Sarkos's project? I know it's in the title is sort of low carbon, but is it really considering every aspect through?
Well, Hans-Jörg has mentioned a lot of those very important topics. So that means a high energy intensive industry remains in the region where it's currently being built. That's the difference in between greenfield development and brownfield transformation. We will keep the industry at where it is by today. We will have significantly less emissions that will, of course, benefit a lot of the neighboring areas. But it's a very locally confined space. So that's an upside for all the people around us. But for those particularly, it will improve significantly. So that's, I think, a big opportunity as well.
I feel like this would be a great Q&A session. But I do have one question before we move on to that part. This is really preserving the industrialized status of Europe. And why is having an industrialized Europe and not deindustrializing Europe and sort of exporting our heavy industries, why is it important for projects like these and these revamping projects that we may not have the space necessarily for a lot of greenfield projects? Why is it important that more brownfield projects start revamping and coming into a 21st century and really transforming? Why is it important to have a strong industrialized Europe today?
Well, on an international level, we have been privileged enough to see a lot of years in where we had a freedom to import materials from everywhere in the world. That has resulted in dependencies, which we particularly the last 2 years have seen. They were not solely beneficial for Europe. Keeping the industry at where it is by today, particularly base material industries, is key. We have a lot of support from the political and understanding also from the political area on that one. So I think it's really, really good to see that happening. Along with that one, it's also, of course, demanding the political areas to understand we also need to make sure and support that the energy intensive industry remains here. So in Germany particularly, the power prices are very high compared with the international context. Gas prices, not only speaking about natural gas, but also hydrogen at present in the area are very high. So there's still some work to be done for the political levels in order to support making sure that we have a reliable decision-making process and we can also rely on the political areas to make sure that this industry sustainably can stay where it is by today.
Yes. Keeping the industry in Europe, it's all about value generation. We have a lot of secondary raw materials in Europe available, scrap. We can utilize scrap. And I'm convinced in the near future, 10, 20, 30, 40 years, if the expansion of the renewable energy grid is done, I'm convinced that from the competitiveness, from the production point of view, we are more competitive than others globally.
Yeah. Exception. Thank you. With that, I would like to open it up to the floor. If there's any burning questions, I'd like to start our Q&A session. If anyone has any inquiries for our two panelists regarding Sarkos.
It's a question for Salzgitter on partnerships, not deindustrializing Europe. But can I ask, in your flow sheets for transition for Salco's production rates, have you also factored, apart from producing hydrogen to use in direct reduction yourselves, have you also factored in the raw material supply, possibly using more green iron with strategic partners or people that you share visions with that come in the form of a DRI or pig iron or metallized material input in your flow sheets for the future? Or is it entirely being self-sufficient in Germany to do this?
Thanks a lot. That's a very, very relevant question. We have a transition program ahead of us in which we have taken phase one. We will install that one direction plant at site. We of course monitor closely with partners in the raw material sector what are actually their interests, their investment interests as well on an international scale. Not only to understand where they are and what they want, but also in order to better understand where can potentially synergies be in the future. So yes, we are of course having a close look on where we are, but the decision is now taken for phase one, and I think it's a really, really good decision for that particular phase one as it is. And we will see how much of raw material comes where and which form. So we are open for any kind of these dialogues as well.
Very good. Any other questions from the floor? Yes.
Okay, so a question on, you said that until 2050, or three decades from now, 50% of the steel will be electric arc made, so to say. And what about the rest 50%? How long will that take? And what can make it go faster than three decades?
This is a very good question, but very hard to answer. yes, 50% will be still based on the BOF converter route. You have a look to India, have a look to other parts in the world. They all have the different pathways for decarbonization, but this will take time. Europe is a front runner. China is also following some 2 or 3 years later. USA, there's a lot ongoing. Southeast Asia, there's a lot of scrap available. A lot of investments are scheduled there. But 30 years is not a long time. 2050, it's already in 27 years. So it's not so much time.
Very good. Any other questions?
I have a question to electricity, which you mentioned, which is a key with replacing of blast furnaces to electrical arc heaters. As we know, it's required much more energy. How do you see how it will be supplied as a green energy? Do you see, the, for example, green ammonia as a right source?
Yes, it will play a major role, ammonia. For electrical energy at the moment, supply of electrical energy, there are a lot investments ongoing for grid expansion to balance the grid in Europe, because the demand and supply is not balanced yet, and this is the first step to balance the grid in Europe. And for sure, hydrogen production, wherever, Australia, Middle East, this will take place. For sure, when our CTO.
It will take place many years. As we know today, I think in Europe, in Oberhausen, Erlikit builds the first electrolyzer plant, but it's only 20 megawatts. So it's just for the for political reasons. Yeah,
it's a start. Somehow you need to start.
ThyssenKrupp with a product building the biggest ammonia, green ammonia, but in the north of the Africa, which is the good location from the sun. Yeah. In Europe, we need much more green energy. So therefore, my question, how do you see how we can achieve this energy?
Because this is also a political question. You know, Germany is investing a lot of solar and wind power and is purchasing as well nuclear energy from France. So there is a start. The will is there to do something, to start. And this will take time. But we need to push. From the industry perspective, we need to push the political direction towards that direction.
Thank you.
Well, if I could just can add to that, I think we have two topics. Because one is the direct electrification on certain areas, like supply of the electrical power necessary for us in order to operate the electric arc furnace. So that's the one area, and we cannot import that electrical power from Australia. So this is the one is the pure electrical energy, and the other one is of course the electrical energy necessary in order to produce the hydrogen. On hydrogen, I often hear and a discussion about do we need ammonia or liquefied hydrogen, or I think it's the or is wrong. I think we need to do that in an inclusive way. I think there's a lot of capacity on green hydrogen needed in different shapes and form. One is ammonia. Electrical in the chemical industry needs a lot of ammonia, so why not supplying them with green ammonia? Other industries need hydrogen in gas form, so why not utilizing production areas, particularly where it best fits to the individual industries, because the demand in the future is so big, so huge, that we need to think this inclusive and not exclusive, not the one or the other. Electrical, particularly ammonia, can be transported already by today in a relatively easy way. We have import terminals available, so we have infrastructure available, potentially not yet in the capacity that we will need in the future, but as such, the industry is existing. We have places on the planet where we can very, very cheaply source electrical power in order to source green ammonia. So we have already everything in place. We just need to invest into the right places and find the right logistical means in order to get material in the cheapest, most economically viable way to where it's required. And it's not an exclusive one or the other. I think we need to do that inclusive.
Absolutely. Do a quick scan for any further. Can I ask a follow-up question to that, speaking of, if I may? Hans-Jörg, you also kind of mentioning about the scope of the supply from Primetals Technologies. There was a lot of and in that scope. It's not simply just one thing or another. And then also to Martin, I mean, so how are we looking at all of these projects, not simply as I've decided for one thing and that's, it's not either or, but it's looking at these projects as ands, a series of different solutions. So on the one hand, how does that define Sarcos's approach? And on the other hand, how does it sort of define Primetals' approach as a supplier then to the industry of how we are seeing connections, not offering this or that, but instead saying, well, maybe this and that, let's say. So what is, on the one hand, Sarcos's look from that perspective, and on the other hand, how is Primetals approaching that?
Yeah. And in that regard, we have a broad portfolio, the portfolio mix, and each product doesn't fit to each customer. Yeah? So here we need to come together. What's the proper design? Which plant is the best for your specific purpose, for your specific supply chain from the raw materials, for your specific customer, for the semi-products, for your products? So here we need to fit together. Yeah? This is the challenge in the beginning. Yeah.
Can you just repeat the question?
Oh, just how is this idea of and, so not either or, but instead looking at let's look at multiple options and maybe we need to combine. So how does that fit into the strategy and outlook of Sarcos's phases, for example?
On the hydrogen topic or on
no,
what do you mean?
Generally. Just
generally? That's a very broad question. Well, Hans-Jörg, just adding to what Hans-Jörg said, it's for us, for our phase one, we have found out that this is the perfect fit. Adding an end, it doesn't mean that in phase two it's already a set decision to come, right? So we will reassess the situation on our phase two. There's a lot of synergies going along with the same part, and there's also opportunities in order to approach the market in a different way and form. We need to redefine our phase two, assess what's the best way for us in order to get to the product that we want to bring to the market. And we will redo that. The good thing for us, we are on our way. And being ready on phase number one is an intermediate position, but the final goal is a full transformation. And that we will do in that network of partnerships that we have built up, that we maintain, And we will further assess where future partnerships can look like and how the business model will look like in the future.
Very good. Thank you. All right, time for more questions. Any other questions? Well, if there are no further questions, I'd like to thank our panelists. Thank you, Hans-Jörg. Thank you, Martin. Thank you for joining us. We will be here in the lounge. Please, we don't bite, as far as I know. I can at least say for myself. But please come up, ask any follow-up questions here in the lounge. Thank you, everyone. Thank you to our speakers once more.
Thanks, Adam.